It was 5 a.m. in the morning and Alyosha's table alarm clock, Slava, made in Soviet Russia, was ringing to wake her up. She had 2 hours before she had to arrive at the factory for her 10-hour shift from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. She jumped out of the bed and immediately rushed to the small bedroom to wash her face and teeth. Then she went back in her room to dress with her working uniform. After she was done, she went to the kitchen. She opened the drawer in the kitchen as she was looking for something to eat. The drawer was empty and all she had was a quarter of a bread and half a kilogram of sugar. Well, better than nothing, she mumbled as she cut a slice of bread and added sugar on it. Alyosha sat down on her wooden chair at the kitchen table to start her morning routine of reading the previous day newspaper and mentally throwing curses at the Communist Party while sipping from her cup the famous Romanian coffee Nekezol and taking bites from the slice of bread with sugar. Nekezol was a coffee substitute as real coffee was pretty much impossible to find and it contained only 1/5 coffee, the balance being barley, oats, chickpeas and chestnuts. It also contained no caffeine. She took the newspaper into her hands and moved her blue eyes over the title. With a revolutionary spirit, advanced consciousness and strong mobilization, the workers from the shoe factory greeted our beloved and powerful father, Nicolae Ceaușescu, in his factory inspection. To hell with those commies, she said quietly as she threw the newspaper away. Before leaving, she remembered that the next day a transport of milk would arrive at the grocery store located in her micro district. Unfortunately for Alyosha, she was alone, living by herself in a one-room apartment. She only had a sister who managed to move to Germany in the 60s that occasionally sent her some goods a few times per year. Her babushka died a few years ago, and any family who didn't have in their apartment a babushka was dysfunctional. It was a big disaster, because there wasn't anyone who could stand in line at the grocery store. Since the milk transport would arrive next day at 8 a.m, people would start gathering in line in front of the store during the night as early as 10 p.m, so Alyosha had to plan this perfectly. After a 10-hour work shift and a walk home from the factory, she would arrive back at her apartment at around 6:30 p.m, and if she wanted milk, that would imply she had to stay awake all night in line, therefore she needed some sleep after work. Svetlana, can you do me a favor, please? Alyosha asked as she gave Svetlana the babushka on the floor above her some money. She asked her if she could go and stand in line from 10 p.m. at the grocery store. She accepted as this was Svetlana's way of making some side money along her pension. It wasn't really about the money because you didn't have what to buy with them. For Svetlana, it was more about getting out of the house and killing some time. Plus, the lines were so huge that she could always hear the latest gossips. After that, Alyosha started her way to the factory. In a strange way, the babushkas and the kids became a currency, a commodity. Everyone would borrow them and make them stand in lines. Regarding kids, they were considered the frontline soldiers. As a babushka or a parent, you wouldn't let your kid go and play outside without two crucial items. One was a rope with the apartment key hanged around their neck, and the second was a folded bag in their pocket. Since they were playing outside, they had eyes like hawks to spot the transport cars. It didn't matter what the car was transporting, and most times you couldn't even know. It could be cheese, meat, milk, bread, and so on. What was important on the other hand was that those kids would yell around in the apartment's blockyard as soon as they spotted the cars and immediately rushed to the only grocery store in the micro district to stand in line. Soon after, there were hundreds of people. It was 6:20 p.m. and Alyosha arrived home after her 10-hour shift. She was extremely tired and hungry, so she went in the kitchen to eat some slices of bread with butter and a bit of salt that she managed to buy from a store on her way back from the factory. Soon after, she went to her bed and set her Slava clock to wake her up at 11 p.m. after 4 hours of sleep. Svetlana told her she will stand in line 2 hours from 10 p.m. until 12 a.m. At 11 p.m, Alyosha woke up and she started preparing for the full night that was ahead of her. She got a thermos with hot tea and carefully folded her C&A bag that she received from her sister. The bags were godsend, it was an item of showing off. It would show that you had relations outside the country and you would hold to it like crazy. If you were giving some stuff to someone, you would ask them to give you the bag back. The Romanians had to always carry a bag, it was mandatory, because if you were passing by a grocery store and you heard a rumor that they are going to bring some food, it didn't matter what, you would instantly stand in line, so you needed to have a bag ready. Alyosha arrived at the line and thanked Svetlana. Now it was a game of waiting around 8 hours in a very cold winter, the entire night just to get a bottle of milk. In front of Alyosha was an old lady, poorly underdressed for those conditions. Alyosha took a sip of hot tea and was contemplating about those lines. They were all the same in every micro district, at every grocery store, with babushkas who would always smell of mothballs, urine and old rags who had worn out shoes and scary looking metal teeth. Standing in line was a society in its own, with its own rules and demography. Bigger families would rotate in turns, bringing foldable small chairs, tea, newspapers and others even bringing a table of chess. At some other lines she even saw people laying down bricks with different names written on them. After a very cold night, the truck with milk arrived at 7:30 a.m. She looked at the people in front of her as they became more agitated and noticed something odd. A gypsy mother arrived with her 5 kids and a few people would start giving money to the gypsy lady to borrow one kid. The trick was to show up in front of the line with a kid next to you so you could receive 2 bottles of milk instead of one. After that, the gypsy woman took her kids back and the deal was done. At 8 a.m, Alyosha got her bottle of milk and she was already late for work. She started running towards the bus station for her overscheduled 10-hour shift at the factory, but now with a smile on her face and a feeling of accomplishment. Hello everyone, I'm your comrade, Intense, and I want to thank you for watching this video and hopefully the first one as well. I read all the positive feedback that you guys gave me on Reddit and different Discords and Steam and wherever I posted the video. In general, the feedback was really positive and encouraged me to continue doing this thing, this series. I'm really happy that there is, happy and surprised that there is so much interest in finding out how communism was. I want to address just a minor problem that I see some people mentioned about, that why I'm not adding enough realism and why, basically this, but I'm trying to base all of this on a specific time frame and it's hard to find. I'm not a great builder and compared to all the gods on YouTube, I can't go extremely realism because it was different in different countries in Eastern Europe. And I'm just trying, my goal here is to learn the game, get better at it, and you know, my ultimate goal is to just show you how was the average day in for an average citizen in Romania in communism and tell you different stories and so on. That's my main goal. I'm not trying to achieve an extremely detailed city and so on. And just as an example, a couple of you mentioned that why there isn't so much trash, there should be more trash in the city. And first of all, I'm not sure how it was in different countries, but most of the Eastern Europe countries had, I don't know the English word, but in Russian it's subotnika and voskreshnika. And basically that means Saturday and Sunday, where people would volunteer for unpaid work to just do cleaning, fix some benches, plant some seeds for new trees, cut the grass and I don't know, collect all the trash, all the garbage, make everything nice and pretty. And you can't expect a lot of trash when everyone was doing this every weekend. So again, you can't compare nowadays to what it was back then. It's complicated. And another thing is, someone mentioned that the roads are looking pretty nice and there shouldn't be, it shouldn't be like that. I looked at some videos because I'm watching a lot of archived videos from national television and I'm reading a lot of articles and I'm doing a lot of research. But I watched a video with Bucharest in the 60s, the capital of Romania, and all the roads were quite nice. I mean the big roads and no cracks, the road was new. I mean, why should there be a lot of roads and damages and so on? It's a complicated matter. Again, don't take this super extreme mode and I'm not trying to achieve extreme realism here, so yeah. Anyway, as you can see, unfortunately I lost my save, my first video save. I had to completely uninstall the game and install it again, get all the new assets and mods and everything and so on. And now I'm building something different. I found a really interesting micro district. I'm not gonna tell you where. If you manage to know it or find it or whatever and write it down in the comments, that would be pretty crazy. I hope, take it as a challenge or a contest or something. But yeah, everything that I'm building here is based on a real life district built in the 70s somewhere in an Eastern European country. And yeah, I hope you will like it, and in the next episode I'm gonna focus more on industrial area and less on residential, cause you already see how I'm building this. So I will see you in the next episode, and I wish you a great week and a great day as well. Thank you, bye bye.